He's not gonna put in how he's coded because it sucks so much. I normally work with tech marketing consulting, and I'm also known as the Angry Themer. I do think about changing my name to the Happy Themer. I know it doesn't have the same like rock and roll spirit to it, so I'm keeping that. The Angry Themer is a column I have in the Google article about theming and doing good stuff. And I'm also a classy maintainer, but that we're going to talk about a little bit later. This is my my Twitter handle that I think you should follow if you want to know the truth about everything that's good in life, which means Google theming. Google lives listening to really, really bad 80s metal and me cooking with my six-year-old daughter. So I'm also, by the way, this is my new name, right? And DK. A lot of people thought that DK was actually standing for Denmark. It's not. It's actually the Dev Killer, which has been my mission for the last 7 or 8 years in Google, is to remove every div I could find in Google Core and rip it out. And it happened in Drupal 8, which I'm extremely proud about. It only took about 2 years. If you have comments on this as well, use the hashtag Drupal Trick, which has been the hashtag that us in the Drupal front end, Drupal 8 group, have been using for the last couple of years. We're still thinking about renaming it to something else. And if anybody have a better name for Drupal Trick, like Drupal front end, or Drupal theming, or Drupal something else, please let us know, because we're too dumb to figure it out ourselves. We've had it up on our weekly meetings for the last month. So it's clear that we don't have the intelligence to fix that. Anyways, until then, use Drupal Trick, throw questions at me, and I can take them on later on. And by the way, if you have questions, come here afterwards and ask me them, or I'm gonna be down in the registration booth at 4. And you think with core maintainer Cutsford, 4-ish, we're going to stand down there and help out fixing the Drupal content. We can talk about theming as well. I can talk about that 24/7, all day tonight at some bar somewhere. But let me just go back to this thing called the Stockholm Syndrome, which has been the thing that the Drupal community has been under for a bunch of years. The Stockholm Syndrome has nothing to do with the Swedish chef or IKEA. Stockholm Syndrome is all about what happens when you have been captured. And you suddenly go from being feeling that you've been trapped by your captors to sympathize with them, which was happening in Drupal 7. Because, you know, Drupal 7 markup like this suddenly turned out to be a good thing in a lot of themers' minds. This was okay. You know, the divisions that we had was a feature, because you have all the classes that you need. What else would you want to do? You know, 5,000 lines of PHP template code was perfectly okay. There's no reason to remove that, because now you can fix everything. And the class group, you know, having a ton of classes on each element was also perfectly okay, because now we could identify it. Nobody stood up or asked the question, like, is this actually a thing we want? Well, until at some point, some of us got a little bit angry about it, and we figured out we need to fix this. And that's been fixed in Drupal 8. What we actually did was we removed the old theme engine and we put in this new theme engine called Trick. Which basically means that the theme functions are now dead, completely dead. They were actually this dead back in November 2015. We got the last commit in where we actually removed the last theme function. So now everything is a template file instead of a function. Basically everything is template files. So in about a year, when you've been doing like 3 or 4 Drupal 8 themes, you're gonna hate me and Carter and Lowry and the rest of the Trick team, because before you had just one big file with a ton of functions in, Now instead you have 200 files instead, and you'll be like, why did you create this monster? Well, let's fix that in about 2 years. Until then, this is how it is. Because the whole idea is that we want to have a theme that is control of everything that is the markup in the CSS. That's kind of where we're at. And the reason for that is, basically that this is what we do in the theme. We make the stuff that the backend comes with make it pretty. So before we can like kind of move on from this, we need to do a little exercise. And that is unlearning PHP templates. And there's only one way of doing that. That is that we all close our eyes. I can see you all, so you need to close your eyes. And now think about all the good things you did in PHP templates. All the things that made so much sense. All the things that will not haunt you in the night. Can you feel it? Can you feel all the good things you did in the themes? Good. Now, open up your eyes. Never again. It is done. All right, so let's talk doing the Drupal and Swift and what that actually is. Well, Swift is a modern, and I love this word modern, because modern just means that it's kind of newish. So in about 3 years, when you look at these templates, like, you know, Swift is old and boring now. We want something new. We want to have Node.js or something headless or blah, 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 blah. Well, right now it's modern. It's built by the Symfony guys, and it's used by other systems. We're not doing our own thing. We can actually use Twig in other systems, which is pretty sweet. And it's easy to learn. And how easy is it to learn? Well, here's what you need to learn. Up here, this is a variable. This is how to do a comment, and this is all kind of the functionalities. And that's it. It's pretty much everything you need. This is the syntax you're going to work with. So another thing you can do, like up here we had that back in Drupal 7 days, how you would go into a variable. What you do now is that you're using these dots instead. So you can like drill into the variable. Some places you need to do it like this with the hashtag, but all that you can read in the documentation later on. But you want to do something fancy to a variable, do it like this. So you put in this pipe, and then you have a function that can do something to this variable, and then you can pass in different parameters to it. And that's it. So let's say I want to take my username, and I want to make it uppercase username. Okay, bang, uppercase, done. Actually, this is not uppercase, it's only upper. And this is just me being an idiot, but I did my slides, and I can tell about it. But that's not the, this is the principle behind that. We even have translate built into it. So up here I have my home city, Copenhagen, and with the pipe and the T, that will translate it. And now this is a string that's translatable, which gave all and the rest of the group which we even have before. We can even do that as a whole block function. So we have, this is a function instead. Trans, and then you can like put in all of your data, the variables and everything, and then you can translate that. So now also the way we write in translatable elements is way easier to look at. We also got another level of kind of control. So if I want to test on something, it's pretty much like reading English. And if the person is 40k, enough to wait, else is not an awesome Viking. That's just the basic if-else commands. Another thing you can do inside of your template files is create a variable as you need them. And we're going to come back to that a little bit later when we begin to work around how we put in classes. But basically what you can do is you use a command called set. Set some variable name and give it a value. And that will print up a value. And the reason for this is that now inside of your template you can begin to put in logic. And I now know if there's English developers in the room, they're going to be like, logic in a template, we can't have that. Because the theme is not grown up enough to handle that. Well, sorry guys, we can, and we're going to use that. We're going to show how we can use that. But basically, it's Twig, and from the Twig, it goes into PHP, and it gets like all kinds of magic stuff. Larry Garfield can explain to you what it actually does, and then it goes to the site. So Twig is not slow. It is fast. The reason for that is like all the templates get compiled. Just like, so we don't get any panic on that. All right, so let's start on looking at a base theme. So when you're gonna build the first template site, how are you gonna do that? Well, basically, there's a different kind of theme that you wanna look at. So first of all, we have Drupal Core. And back in Drupal 7, Drupal Core gave you everything. Right off the bat, all the HTML, all the CSS and classes and stuff. And you could do stuff with it. Now in Drupal 8, what we're going to do, we're going to do the same thing. Drupal 8 is going to give you the same amount of like data and stuff, but we're going to pass all that through this new theme called Classy. And Classy is where all your classes are defined. So if you want to change anything on that, that's where you're going to do that. And that's where we're going to create all this. But this also means that you can actually walk around this. So if you don't like what Drupal does out of the box, all around can be done. So themes in Jubilate is basically built up like this. So we have core out here, then we have this theme called stable, then we have classic, and then that's seven and body. But stable is actually a copy of Jubilate core. So what we can do now is the stable is, this is basically Jubilate core, 8.0 core. What we can do now in Jubilate core is that we can begin to develop that on 8.1, 8.2, 8.3. We can begin to do putting new functionality because stable and classic will always stay the same. So we won't disjoint any of the things that you work on with you behind these views. They're just going to stay with the same markup, the same classes coming up. So if you're relying on that, but Jubilate core can still improve. And this is a huge change compared to how it used to be in Jubilate 7, where we couldn't do anything on it. And then you have 7 body, which by the way is going to be their own special charts. So we're going to look into them. All right, so what do stable do? Stable do this, nothing. Just gives you a couple of divs, maybe a session tag, no classes, unless they're extremely necessary for Jubilate, then they're going to have a JS dash prefix on. Classy is going to have all the fancy stuff that you maybe like, maybe don't like. But now there's things that you can work on. Because one of the things we learned during this process of Jubilate was that about 25% of our themers want to have a complete nothing to work out from. They just want to build everything from scratch. That is what they want to do. But about 75% really like basic markup and basic classes and just open up your Jubilate site and have something to theme on, put on some CSS, make that headline event. So that's why we have classy there. So classy is well default markup. Seventh and body, or to a base theme that Jubilate comes with, is now based as being internal. And internal means that we can basically Jubilate 8 will do to in new versions of it, both 7 and body will be able to change. So if you want to do a base theme, your theme want to be by the 7 or body, please do a copy of 7 and body, put that into your own theme folder, and then do a base theme on that. Because else 7 and body will change during the next couple of years, so we can actually make it better. So we don't, it's frozen in time as we've been in Jubilate 7. Because of Jubilate 7, we never, in a 4-year period, 5-year period actually, we couldn't make body responsive. Why? Because people were relying on it. We can do that now. So we're kind of trying to set up our base theme in a way that we know that we already failed, so making sure that we can actually move around it. So basically, it's when you start a new theme, you go like, okay, how's my base theme going to be? I'm going to use stable, or I'm going to use classy. That all depends on how kind of the style you want. You can also just go like, you know what? Fuck it, I'm just going to write my complete own, just going to rock it, I'm going to build it directly in Jubilate core, and I'm going to have the base theme false, which means that you're going to get this stuff that comes directly from Jubilate core, and we do not know what that's going to be. And when you come whining in about 2 years because something changed, that's going to be your own headache. So just so you all know that. But it's there so you can build that. I'm going to be one of the dumb fucks who's going to do that, but that's a whole other thing. So basically, just remember this, stable is where, like, this is the stable Jubilate code. Jubilate core, if you want to rely on that, don't rely on that, but that's where the calling is going to be. Classy is your basic class as Jubilate 7 was. And then 7 and body, just use them, don't use them as your base theme. If you want to use them as a base theme, copy them into your own folder and work from there. That way, you're not going to get headaches later on. Alright, bang. So, another thing on Jubilate templates, as you're going to see here, is like when you get into them and look at them, this is things have been reorganized a lot. Jumped in there. Let's just try to define how you do your base theme. So, a base theme is basically you have your theme folder, you put in your info file, then your YAML file, and your theme name in, and you do base theme class. That's going to be that of base theme table. Or here, by the way, we have Emma is here already. I'm here. Lewis is here as well, but he's not 7 main maintainer anymore. So we're going to do this. But we actually have 3 or 4 like core maintainers at the conference. And we have a core committer as well. So if you're really interested in figuring out what's going on, it's actually a pretty good spot to figure that out because we're in the room. So let's set up a new theme because that's going to be a little bit of fun. So where do you live now? Well, actually where your theme is going to live is down in your root folder slash themes slash your theme name. compared to in back in Drupal 7 times where you have to put in site slash over slash whatever, now the tags are just jumping directly here without anybody laughing at you. And I know this is like, this is a big step. I know it sounds strange, but if you've never worked with Drupal, Drupal before, this would like make logical sense, but this is actually, well, to me, this makes a lot of sense. So you have your themes, or have your modules directly out of the room. You just drop it in here. Your themes don't have a bunch of config files that you need to understand. They're kind of easy to get, actually. First of all, is the info file. Your info file is where you have the theme configuration and where you call in some of the elements to some CSS and some JS. So basically, you have your basic info up here. You have libraries, some kind of function libraries, in a second. And then you have a command to remove CSS that might have come from a module somewhere. And then you have like how to define the different regions. In this one, this is actually the style sheet remove is a command we have inside the info file. And inside of that, you can then go in and say, if there's a style sheet coming somewhere from a module that you include, you want to remove that. This is where you can remove them one by one. There's not built in a kill switch yet. We have been talking about it, so you can actually just do a command that just said, like, remove everything to the call. But it requires a little bit of before we do that. But this is the way you're going to remove the CSS file that comes from somewhere that you don't want to have, because maybe it's interfering with you somehow. And by the way, before you go like nuts in like taking notes, I do have all the slides online. There's going to be a link at the very last, so you can get all this info as well. Libraries is a new thing to play, at least from the theming perspective. So a library is basically just where you add your CSS and your JavaScript. And the reason that we're using libraries is that modules is using them as well. And we kind of want to use it the same way. And libraries work like this. So I have my info file, and I call in my library from the info file. I say, OK, use this library. And inside of this library, you can have, you know, JS and JavaScript. The idea behind this, let's say you build a slider. You want to build that into your theme. You basically just define that in. And then you can call these files. So you only can call in that library when you actually need it, so you can like separate yourself up. And how you do this? Well, here's my library I'm calling in up here. Libraries, Yggdrasil is my theme name. Yggdrasil is very much as much Viking folklore as you can get. It's a big tree that we have. Anyways, global, and down here's my name for global, and here I define it. This is my version one of it. Here's my CSS. Here's my CSS theme file. And here, calling my style, my print file sheet. Here's my JavaScript component, and here's dependencies down here. All right, if you look into that a little bit more, so we have the name for it, we have the CSS files, we have the JavaScript, and this dependency. This one is interesting. This is a dependency that tells me, okay, theme, now if I call in this library, now you should use jfile. That means if you don't have to have jfile inside of your theme, and you don't define it, you're missing 32 kilos of awesome JavaScript. But if you don't use jfile for it, you don't have to add it, so it's actually separated jQuery away from the theme unless you actually want it. Or, hey, I want to use jQuery 3 instead of 2 or instead of 1.8. You can just jump that in. Inside of libraries, we can do another thing as well. We can do overrides of other libraries, and we can remove other libraries that's coming in. So if you have defined libraries somewhere and your theme want to do something with it, say the messages or some kind of layout or dialogue, whatever it could be, you can actually from your theme explain to Drupal directly, don't do this. And the reason that we're putting all these things in there, we don't want to have people to run around inside of PHP files trying to figure out how to do this. So actually make it visible and logical for the theme to work with this. CSS has been organized a little bit different. We're using SMAX terminologies. Do people know what SMAX is? No, okay. SMAX there's a very good blog post about it done by a Canadian dude. I have a link for it. But basically, it's an idea of how to organize your CSS. And the way you're doing it, you have a thing called base. And base is a folder where you have all like your default classes for a body tag, for a div, for a link, for whatever it can be, all of these things. Then you have layouts. Layout is kind of like where you define all of how your layout, how things are designed, you know. How your comments is, then you have a component. The component could be a slider, or it could be, you know, my article, a comment. So all these things you kind of define into the little box. Then you have state. A state would be if a menu is active, if it's active, it's not active, what it can be. And then you have theme. Theme would be like different colors, basically different elements. The whole idea of this is that you separate the CSS files up into simple little elements, and that makes it way easier further down the road to have to figure out what's going on. This is a dude, I'm gonna put the link to it there later on. It's one of the core principles we're building our CSS on. So, that's a basic CSS. It'll be a great point because you're responsive websites. What you can do now from your file is we have a breakpoints file. And in that, inside of that, you define, you have to see this. The problem is this is a screenshot. okay. Anyways, the PDFs for it when you download is really sweet and it's also documented. The idea is that you inside the file you define your breakpoints, you define different sizes for it, and those breakpoints you can use now inside of your modules inside of your site. So that's how. So we don't have a GUI for it, we define that in your theme. And that's actually a pretty sweet theme, because now your theme defines your image sizes for that theme, which, in my mind, makes a lot of sense. So that's not separated, it's built into your theme. If you go into panic mode right now, and go like, hey, Morten, why did you remove all this awesome stuff that we do with PHP? Well, we haven't removed that file. PHP template is still there. It's just called .theme. So you can still go in and build and do all kinds of crazy things in PHP as you want to. But one of our dreams was to make the system as easy as possible for people to work with and don't have them to constantly jump in and having to work in a PHP layer. Because jumping from constructing CSS objects to jumping into PHP and going from design to PHP constantly is kind of a mind bender for a lot of people. So we really want to make sure that didn't happen. So let's say you want to add or do something to it, you can still do that in your theme file. But we're not going to stay with that because that's kind of another talk. And I know that Lowry, are you speaking at this conference? Oh, okay, damn it. Lowry has done a really good talk. No, Hunter is going to talk tomorrow about it at the same time. Yeah, right? Same room? No. Hunter's having a talk tomorrow, way more about that and what we can actually do with like programming stuff. I just like to make stuff clean. And YouTube, we've got a new way as well. And this is going to kind of blow your mind, I hope, too. So to get that tool to work, you're going to change your settings a little bit. And the reason you're going to change the setting is that now we can begin to figure out what actually goes on inside the Drupal 18. And you want to download Devel. And the reason you want to download Devel is, well, Devel gives you a lot of opportunities, a lot of the things you can do. And Devel also gives Kint in it. So what you're going to do is, if you use Drush, you install Drush, enable Kint. And there's a whole guide down here, Drush, all English math, and it's all how to get all this stuff up. You can also just download Devel, but that's not the section. Next thing you want to do, disable CSS cache. Drupal 8 comes with CSS cache enabled from the get-go, which drives me personally batshit, because every time I start a new site, I throw in my theme, I reload my page, and nothing happens. Well, because the CSS is enabled, so just disable that. And let's look at theme debugging, how that works. So, I'm in my services file right now. Inside my service file, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to change my cache to false and setting the cache to be enabled. And here we see the normal page. This is like Drupal 8 out of the box. I was told by Americans that this band is so bad that everybody should know it. It's a terrible band, and a lot of us hate it. Anyways, the point here is that it puts out a class name called Nickelback, and I don't want to have that in my theme, so how do I do that? Well, what you can do and how we think classes is you have three kind of levels of it. You have essential classes. Essential class is something Drupal puts out that it needs to do something. It can have is visible. That's a class we use to test your stuff is visible so we can make accessibility work. It could be a JavaScript class that you need to have to make some kind of stuff work. It could be something that's actually important. Then you have modules. Modules can add classes too. They can be with variable attributes, you can add class. And this is what the back enabled module does, add class, nail back in. It becomes classy, and classy puts in all kinds of other stuff that I want to put in. This is also coming through before. So this is now all about chain of all the classes coming in. So to remove them, instead of doing add class, do attributes.remove Nickelback. Bang! And it's out. I could even go further and say, I also want to remove the things that Paul put up, so I only have the task that comes from my theme. That is the power of like, the whole remove command. So back made in model go for Nickelback. Attributes remove this class, Nickelback. Voila. The thing when we talk about classes, one thing you don't want to remove is JavaScript prefix classes. JavaScript prefix class is, and every time you write anything with JavaScript, whether you need a CSS class or something, please prefix it with JS. And the reason you want to prefix it with JS, first of all, so you can remember what you did 6 months ago. Second of all, you're also telling everybody else, this is used by JavaScript. And by having this used by JavaScript, you should not use this for adding in colors or anything else. This is purely to have the JavaScript to be able to identify something. And if you want to have, like, so this is JS, dash whatever, that's meant for JavaScript. And then if you want to put pretty color in, do it with a separate class. Just get the same name for it. Now it also makes sense to you for the actually doing these classes. Clean class, as I said, is cleaning up the class and making sure that, that whatever name you put in, the variable comes out of the system, is actually usable. So attributes, you can remove a class, you can add a class, you can even set an attribute. And here I'm actually adding an ID to an element. So you can go like div, ID, top, class, rush. So now from your theme, you can control all these wonderful attributes, which is pretty sweet. So let's make the field of attributes actually work together so we can do something with them. So I hope you remember this, I was talking about a little bit before. This is our field of how we can build this. We always want to make sure that Drupal can work with whatever we put out, so we're going to add these things in. This is how we build out Drupal's basic classy stuff. So a field, all fields always have a field class, they have a field item on it as well. See here, I have the label in. This is how classy builds it thing out. So, and this is just, this is how you, when you're looking at a field, like, why is this built up this way? Well, because a field underscore label, field underscore item, so kind of have using passive. Same thing with field items, we're doing the same thing, just making sure that the information is building up. So, this is like war theory on it. So let's look a little bit on a little demo I did here on how to actually do this on a field. So I go in and expect this. And this is my basic markup coming out. You know, I don't need these things. I don't need field items. I'm just going to add in a few classes on it. So as you can see here, I'm changing them to an honorable list instead of an LI instead. This is also just a demo that I'm actually not completely lying. Should be sad. All right, so now we have an honorable list instead. See. And here's the one of the good things when you record your videos and you kind of crop it the wrong way. This is still my epic failure. I'm like doing stuff further up. You're going to see that in a second. Just cleaning stuff up, actually. I'm removing this field. The class is still keeping the classes in there. All right, so now I have a completely naked markup directly out of Drupal without destroying anything. So let's add some classes into it and figure out how that's done. So to add classes in, to add JavaScript, to add CSS in, you need to add in the library. And the library works like this. So basically, the libraries is just a way of adding in a bunch of CSS and adding in JavaScript and making sure that you can all kind of move it around. I'm adding in a file here called Barcelona to my library. And inside of my fields, what I'm doing now is I'm actually doing, inside of the field, I'm doing an attached library, Barcelona, and this field. So if I have one specific template that needs this specific CSS, but only when that's loaded, I can actually just call that directly from my theme file. I don't have to do that often in a pre-process or somewhere else. It's actually built in where you would actually use it. So Barcelona element is now loaded in. So, let's add in the classes. As you can see, I've done some really advanced CSS here. I have my LI with something gray on, I have the first and the last. I have a color red and a color yellow. And And this is for the demonstration purpose only, of course. So here, first I'll do a set pause. And I'll do a fancy little thing. I'll do a cycle through it. So a cycle would mean that it do a kind of an odd even. It just goes like a little circle. So if I want to make sure each class get added here, as you can see, I'm just going to add in my colors as I want to have color yellow, color red. And I do it on a loop index. So these are like small little tricks you can do to it, to how to work on it. Next thing I'm doing here, I'm saying, okay, if I'm on the first loop, add in this color. If I'm on the last loop, add in the last class. So if you need each classes based on where you are, this is kind of way of like iterating on each of these elements. So, or even better here is, if I'm on the third element of this list, and I want to give it a specific color, I can do that just by a simple count. All right, so let's say I actually want to change some stuff. Also here when I'm at the specific elements. So when I'm on the third element, I actually want to add in a complete new model. It shouldn't be the same thing. So what I'm doing here is, you see the loop.index? Loop.index is actually where you count. So that's just the count on it. I can pretty much do whatever I want with it. So first of all, I have my else command. Else down here in the bottom. So that tells me, like, if the first part is not, if it's not 8, just do what you've done always. But else, you know, let's do something else. Let's completely change everything on it. Let's do an H1 tag instead and write something in. And yes, I know this is just an example, just to see what we can do, but sometimes it's good as well. So Drupal 8 is coming up when it's ready. And this is what you can do now directly inside of the template, without having to ask Drupal 8 or for anything for it at all. And the crowd went nuts. No excitement at all? None. None whatsoever. So I gave this talk back in a back camp in San Francisco, and I asked, okay, why is nobody going crazy about this, dancing on the table? And I was one just saying, like, as dry as she could, but more than this just makes sense. And I was kind of like, oh. And this is actually where I figured out that I was haunted down by the Stockholm Syndrome, that I've been for so many years, been so excited that I could do this directly out of the template without having to like walk around and pre-configuring all kinds of stuff. It was just working as I want to make it work. So the secret holy grail on this is like, you do a for loop inside of your field, you have four items and items, you count on the length of the elements. If it's the first loop, you want to do something, last loop, just a certain number, you can like count into it. This is the second element of my loop. Or you can even do a reverse count. So I want to have the third last element of this whole list of stuff, and it should be have the sparkle going class. You can add that. Or I just have my default. If you have this for loop in, you can do whatever you want with your markup. You want to add in the CSS template, attach library, dename library, just call that in. So now from your template file, you can control all the elements that you want. Pretty cool. Okay, cool. What should we use it for? Okay, cool. Good. Another cool thing we put in is a trick block. It's not a block, it's a trick block. What's a trick block? Well, the idea behind a trick block is that, let's say you have this paint template. Inside of a paint template, you want to be able to like, change elements around. Anybody got a timer? Oh shit, I'm almost out of time. Okay, so the page template, let's say that you want to put something in on the front page. How can you do that? Well, with a trick block, we can do that. A trick block is a way you define a block inside of a template, and inside of the template, now we can inject other templates. It's like secret, super powerful templates, which goes like this. Let me show you a quick example of this on a little video I did a long time ago. So here's my page. What I'm doing here is, let's see, I'm defining my block first. And we call it the trick block, so we don't get confused with Drupal blocks. We did have the discussion if we should rename it to something else, like getting Drupal to be named blocks to boxes or something else, but we figured out that would be like a 6-year dog fight in the issue queue, so we came up with just calling this a trick block instead. That also makes sense, so if you go into write trick documentation and you ask what a block is, this will make sense to you. So here make a block that's called Modern UK is Awesome. And what it have is just have a green class on it. So let's load this page. Bang! Here's the trick block. This is just a block that's living inside the template page. And if you go and look at it, see here it is. Here's the sneaky part. How do you overwrite this? Well, you do that by looking at the theme name suggestions. Page --- node. On this example, also have a page --const. So I'm going to create a new file now, page const. And inside of this page const, I'm doing the extend command. And extend tells Trick System that, hey, this page is an extension to a specific point. I'm copying over my whole template, or my template, my block of data. And I'm going to put some fancy text into it, and I'm going to change the class to blue so we can see it's working. So, then extends, and then you need the whole themes slash my theme name slash templates for the template div, and say it's another trick. If we change that to a shortcut, there's a shortcut for it now. We can talk about that later. Anyways, now I'm explaining to my system, hey, on this page, I'm not a page anymore. I'm a trick block. I'm extending somewhere else. So let me do a reload on this. Ooh, sexy. And now I have my page. So, you don't need to have 8 different page templates anymore if you just want to put in like a specific banner on the front page or something else. You have the exact same markup all over. You can just put in these little blocks. And it doesn't only work on a page, you can do that. You can even do a trick block on a block template. And then you can have another block template and you can go completely nuts in that. I wouldn't recommend it because your brain is going to burn out or figure out where it actually came from, but this is how a trick block works. So basically, I want to add in a hero element on my page, and I can extend on that page HTML and be done with it. That's how it works. And you can do it on everything, on the field, whatever you want to do, do it on. Alright. Few last things. So another thing we put in, which I think is really awesome, is a new screenshots. So screenshots can now actually take a field type. So if you want to put a dance inside your field inside of your screenshot instead, you can do that. So you can actually have your overview of your page looking like this. You can also do something like that actually would make sense, like 3 different ways of how your theme looks in different browsers or whatever. But when I figured this out by coincidence, because somebody put in actually used PNG files, they were like, can I add a GIF file in? Yes, I can. I am an evil human being. And it was a great day to figure that out. Another thing, like menus and pages. Pages elements for every theme in the world is the most feared thing when you're looking at a design for your developers and they go like, yes, I want to have this really, really awesome page and it should look like this. And you're just going to look into that. You're trying to explain to your project manager why this will take you 3 workdays. Because pages in Drupal 7 was, how to put it politely, not so good to see. That is the polite version of it. Menus was a pain in the ass as well. So this is a menu now in Drupal 8. A menu is just 1 template file. It's no more 3 functions and 4 different template files. It's just 1 file with all the, yes, it's a little bit complicated, but you can actually see what goes on. Your menu.html.2 file. The pager, that was like epic fun for everybody. Here's our new pager. I know it has a lot of markup in. We maybe should fix this in 8.1 if we can still get it in. There's code freeze in about 3 weeks, something like that. Anyways, your pager is just 1 big file. One of the principles we really tried to push into Drupal 8 was we would rather have all of the data presented directly into the themer so you can work with it instead of trying to hide it away. Because there was this concept way back for many years in the world of Drupal that, you know, themers shouldn't be exposed to all these advanced elements. And kind of the world of themers was like, can I pretty please just get all the stuff so I can make it work in these 25,000 different devices and screen sizes and stuff? So we changed that as well, the page HTML. So if you want to dig into this, you're like, how and where do I even start? I started a project called Vanilla. And Vanilla is my learn all the things theme. Of course, start by drawing a little icon for it because that's the most important thing. But it's on google.org/projects/vanilla. I, of course, have not yet put anything up there, but it's all at my GitHub account. GitHub account has more details as vanilla. Where you can actually also download my new theme from my own website, which I've not put up yet, but all the code is in there. And it's just a ton of different templates where I'm trying to figure out how to break stuff and how to make stuff work. Because another thing that is kind of, maybe we didn't say that so loud when we just came up with JuBlade and we were all so excited, but a lot of the stuff we put into JuBlade came in one by one. We never got the chance to take 3 steps back and looking at the whole system in a whole, how stuff actually works. So we're constantly finding new things that is not making sense. Also because the group of people who did that was at the end of the day a very small group, about 10 to 20 people. So you tend to work in very small elements and you don't work in the big picture. So what we really hope to see is when you guys begin to work with JuBlade, work with the team system, is actually giving us feedback to how it works and how stuff works out. Also, by the way, if you grab this, I have a ton of all these little snippets I showed you. They're all in here as well. It's just in a big article, so it's different, so I can remember them as well. So for those of you guys who actually didn't listen or fall asleep, because I'm a boring old man, these are kind of like the core points that happen in JuBlade. IE 6, 7, 8 is not supported by JuBlade at all. By the way, Microsoft dropped support for IE 8, 9, and 10 2 months ago. So that's one of the good things. We cleaned up the markup file into HTML5. CSS is smack and bang based. We used modern practices, we removed all the IDs, and the 7th theme is responsive. We have separated JavaScript out, all JavaScript classes, and the JS prefix on it. We killed 90% of the visits because of all the stuff we did on the fields. jQuery dependency, we removed that as well. Stable and classy is put in now as your basic themes, so you can go each way you want to theme your stuff. 7 and buying is internal elements, so they can just, you can just build on them. And as the last thing, I actually want to have the, anybody here work on Swift? Can you please stand up? Thank you. I'm extremely proud to be a part of that journey for the last 2-3 years, officially 7 years for me. So, I love you guys a lot, and girls. If you are excited by this, you should actually join us. As you can see, this is me. This is Joel. I'm in Copenhagen. He's over in Canada, all the other side of the world. This is how we work, scratching our head. Every Thursday, we have a meeting. You can either just listen in, and just see what we're talking about this week. And this will be everything from what we want to do, what's working, what's not working, who's going to which conference, where we're going to go, where we're going to work on this code. It's 5 o'clock Copenhagen Central European Time. I think it's 11 o'clock here because 5 hours, 22, is 10 because I can't count. I can fix that. Yes. So at 10 o'clock Thursday nights here in Mumbai, join us on the weekly trick call. You can just listen in. I think the room for like 10 people. And then we also have the trick channel, IRC channel, where we are having discussions. Or just join the docs. And that is where we kind of try to plan these stuff. Because one thing where we've got all this stuff into Drupal Core, that's not enough. We want to keep on improving. And as you saw us as one of the first things I was to show you guys that Drupal 8, we can work on Drupal 8 core markup, mark elements that comes out, how Drupal 8 does stuff. And we have 2 themes of making sure that we can do all this stuff because Stable has separated that out. And that's why we have the Stable theme there. And we really need feedback. Is it
9:30? It's
9:30. Yeah. Jesus. The world is big and I'm a small little man. I don't understand stuff. So, alright, let me just change this again. How do you have stuff? God damn it, I don't even understand. Yeah, there's a state in the US with only more like except summertime, so God damn it. Anyways, come and join us. If, by the way, by any chance you should be in Europe in May, you should actually come and join us at the Frontend United Conference. The Frontend United has been a thing we've done for our like 5 years. That is a front-end only conference. Developers are very welcome. We will like point fingers at them and laugh at them, because that's what they have been doing to us for years. Oh yeah, it's payback time. it's a very focused, funded discussion. This is actually 3 years ago, 4 years ago in Amsterdam. That was actually where we kickstarted all this. Half of the tickets are already sold out. We have refining pretty awesome speakers. So it's everything funded, but based out of Drupal. So there's also going to be a lot of talk about SVG and so forth. So think about joining that. I do not know yet if we're going to video or broadcast somehow. I hope that we can do that, because it's kind of a European-only event at this point. But we are thinking about figuring that out somehow, but we need to find a video camera and how to do that, but we're going to figure that out. Questions, use Twitter, use Drupal Twig, throw questions at us. We get sickly excited, mad excited when people go like, oh, I'm using this and how does it actually work? Because we have been in the trenches for 3 years and just working around with this and don't know how people would even react to this. So use that. And questions and comments and feedback, please throw them at me at my Twitter account, MortonEK. That's kind of my primary place where communicate this stuff out and try to get stuff working. And yes, I've used my last 3 years of my life to get this stuff done. I used pretty much since 2007, I think, when I came into Drupal the first time. And I looked at the theme system and thought, nah, I can clean this markup in 6 months. And 8 years later, I was still like, how do we do this stuff? So every time my ego gets too big and I think I'm the most awesome dude in the world, I kind of look back on my very first DrupalCon and I was like, okay, Morten, maybe you're an idiot and need to listen to other people. And that's one of the great things about being in a big community, because, you know, 8 years ago, I was the only one who identified myself as a designer. And I still identify myself as a web designer, because I've been in this business now for 20 years. How many of you, is there any 20 years old in this room? Yeah, you're not 20 years old. You did rock concert before I was even born. Yeah. No, it's just crazy for me to figure out there's actually people at sessions I'm giving that was born before I did my first markup. That's kind of freaking me out. I'm also getting a little bit of gray hair and like losing a little bit of hair. It's like all gone bad. What's happening there? Alright, so anyways, with all that, my name is Morten DK. I am actually the happy themer, and thank you all for actually attending my session, and thank you for making me welcome in Asia. And I kept it to an hour. Yes, here, by the way, here's the slides. Kind of your part. This is Batcam 15. It's the same slide set.